All right, we're in Matthew chapter 7. Verse 1. So last time we were in Matthew, we were in Matthew 6, verses 25 through 34. And we talked quite a bit about the sin of worry last time. How it's the same thing as if you were to lie or to steal or any other commandments that people break. Do not worry is just as important a command as do not lie. Therefore, it's just as important to obey it. I asked you last time if there was anything you were worried about, money, possessions, a person, a situation, your job, etc. And now it's been a couple weeks. I ask you the same thing. Is there anything in your life you're worried about? If not, there is a solution to it. We also talked about how the definition of worry in the English dictionary, the first definition we saw was to choke or strangle, which was surprising to me. I'm sure to all of you. It also means to harass by tearing, biting, or snapping, especially at the throat, to shake or pull at with the teeth, to touch or to disturb something repeatedly, to change the position of or adjust by repeatedly pushing or hauling. These are the primary definitions of the word worry in the English dictionary. Pretty amazing to me, the spiritual implications of such a definition of these. And we related these definitions to the parable of the sower, especially to the thorny ground hearer. How the cares of this world and worrying about them can cause the seed of the Word of God to be choked, to be strangled out of your life. Whether it's just the Bible, what the Bible says, or God's Word specifically spoken to you. Worrying can cause you to not trust God or His Word, because you are taking your eyes off of Him and His Word to you and putting your gaze upon the thing or person you're worrying about instead. Then you end up walking in your own wisdom, your own strength, and end up outside of God's will, which of course is the most dangerous place to be, outside of God's will for your life. And the solution to the temptation to worry is to look to Jesus as the only one who can truly satisfy you for anything and everything. No other person, no other thing can satisfy like Jesus can. Not a certain job, not money, not comfort in this life, not a relationship with anyone else, not a child, not a situation or circumstance. We must look to Jesus to satisfy our every need. And then we must trust Him in what His Word says. Must seek first His kingdom and His righteousness. You must give burdens and concerns over to Him via prayer. It's the only way we will truly have peace in this life. And of course, worrying is the absence of, or the opposite of, having the peace that passes understanding. So we need to make sure we're not being worrisome in this life about anything or anyone. Okay, Matthew 7, 1 is where we're starting today. It says, judge not that you be not judged. For with judgment you judge, you will be judged. And with the measure you use it, it will be measured back to you. And why do you look at the speck in your brother's eye, but do not consider the plank in your own eye? Or how can you say to your brother, let me remove the speck from your eye, and look, a plank is in your own eye? Hypocrite. First, remove the plank from your own eye, and then you will see clearly to remove the speck from your brother's eye. Do not give what is holy to the dogs, nor cast your pearls before swine, lest they trample them under their feet and turn and tear you in pieces. So if we simply stop at the first two words of verse 7, judge not, we might actually come away with what most people do. Judge not. You can't judge anyone, anything, or anytime. That's how most people come to this verse. And most people, I mean, this is probably the most known verse, just the first two words it is, in all the world. This is coming from a person who's been preaching open air for the last 17, 18 years, thousands of times. I hear this verse more than anything else. They know this better than Romans 3:23, better than John 3:16, they know this verse. Better than he without sin gets the first stone. They know better than that. Okay? It's the most known verse, just the first two words. So if we just read just the first two words, we might come up with the same doctrine most people have. You can't judge anyone for anything at any time, for any purpose. Or many people like to say, thou shalt not judge, which it doesn't say there, but they love putting the King James language into it. It makes it sound more authoritative, I guess. And some people even claim that it's one of the Ten Commandments. I've heard that several times, actually, believe it or not. Of course, when we read and study Scripture, we know that we can't just take the first two words of a sentence or a verse and think that's the whole story. We can't do that. And we know we can't strip verses from their immediate context, the context of the book they're in, of the testament they're in, or from the whole Bible. That's simply not the way it works. And not just with the Bible. You know, we talk about hermeneutics and understanding the Bible. These principles don't just apply just to the Bible. With any writing you have. Take, for example, when I was in Army basic training and job training in Fort Sill, Oklahoma. This is back in 1996. Okay? A long time ago. My dear mom, my loving mom, my wonderful mom, wrote me letters. I think she's the only one who did. I missed home. You know, I was in this strange place, and she wrote me letters, and I'm thankful for it. Do you think I opened these letters and read just the first two words? And said, that's what my mom's saying to me. That's all she said, is just those first two words. Or maybe I just like pulled it out every once in a while, like maybe every day, and read a couple words here and there, or a sentence here and there. Did I do it like that? Is that how I found out what my mom was trying to tell me from Maryland all the way to Oklahoma when she was writing letters to me when I was in basic training and job training? No, I didn't do that. I read the whole thing at one time in order to understand what she was saying to me. And I didn't want to miss it because I missed her. I wanted to hear what she had to say. I wanted to know what she was saying to me. And God's word is no different. We need to read it like that. Of course, one difference between my mom's letters and the Bible is inspired by the Holy Spirit. So some things that are found in the Scripture, it takes the Holy Spirit to understand them. The deeper things of God. Not the gospel, sin, righteousness, and judgment. Everybody can understand those things. But the deeper things of God takes the Holy Spirit to understand. And there are spiritual forces of wickedness trying to get you to misunderstand the Bible, to twist it, and to keep you away from diligently studying it. Now, there was no devil that's trying to keep me away from reading my mom's letter, okay? From understanding what she was saying. There's no devil that's trying to get me to just read a verse here and there of my mom's letters when she wrote me in basic training. But there are demons seeking to keep you away from this, from sitting down and diligently reading it. These demons try to keep the sinners from actually understanding what the Bible actually says about them and how they can be saved. So there is a difference. These spiritual forces of wickedness can influence in these ways on their own, or they can even use false teachers to do so. There are some reasons why people don't understand or don't even try to understand what the Bible is saying in Matthew 7:1. Number one, they don't have the Holy Spirit. Number two, spiritual forces of wickedness, false teachers. Number three, then of course, there's plain old laziness. Laziness. They don't care to understand what it says. Another one is that their own sin blinds them. But what most would say that Matthew 7:1 says, or at least they hope it says this, that you can't tell people they're wrong. That's what the first two words of Matthew 7:1 are saying. You can't tell anyone they're wrong. They also think it says, you can't criticize me for my choices. You can't tell me to stop doing what I love to do. You can't tell me my choices will lead to hell. Or to sum it up nicely, leave me alone and let me sin in peace. That's really what they're getting out of these first two words. All that stuff they're getting out of two words, judge not. Amazing how much people read in to what the Bible says and take out of it what they want to take out of it. And most people probably have never even read it for themselves, not even Matthew 7:1, even the first two. They probably never read it for themselves, whether on their phone or physical Bible. They don't even know where it's found in the Bible most times. They just know it's in there. They just know the Bible has to teach, judge not, or thou shalt not judge. Typically, they've heard it from someone else, and it sounds good to their ears. It tickles their ears. So they just go with it because they love their sin. Of course, by using this verse in that skewed way, they are telling you that you are wrong. They are criticizing your judging of them and their choices, which is your choice. They're telling you to stop judging others and preaching the word of God to them. And oftentimes they'll tell you that God hates your judgment and that your judgment of them will send you to hell. And they're very pleased with that. And most of them even see their hypocrisy in doing all these things. They just keep pressing on, doing the very things that they've saying to you that you shouldn't be doing. Then they'll get an applause from others who are blind and walk in delusional victory like they had a mic drop moment or something by getting people to agree with them. All the while not knowing this verse, what this verse says, and what this passage is actually speaking against what they just did. That's what it's actually speaking against, what they just did. Not what you did, and they criticized. Of course, when a preacher comes along and challenges it, and they look it up on their smartphones and takes them through the whole context, they might feel a little dumb if they're opening their eyes to it. They actually want to know what it says. Verse 2 says, "For with what judgment you judge, you will be judged, and with the measure you use, it will be measured back to you." So judge not that you be not judged. It's not a universal declaration that we find in verse 1 that God is against judgment altogether, or that he forbids humans to judge. Such a position could not stand the whole counsel of God's word or the scrutiny of any logical mind. However, verse 2 begins to make things clearer for us. At this point, it seems to be saying that we need to be careful how we judge others. It seems to give a kind of reap what you sow principle when it comes to judging. And this makes sense to me. I mean, earlier in Matthew 6, we spoke about forgiveness. We spoke about how if you don't forgive others, God will not forgive you. We even went to Matthew 18, looked at the parable of the unmerciful servant, how he was given great mercy and forgiven of a great debt that he couldn't deal with himself, he couldn't pay back. But then his fellow servant had a very small debt, and he, a very insignificant debt, and he would not have mercy on him. And when the unmerciful servant did that, God revoked his forgiveness from that servant. So a little bit of like reaping what you sow. You sow unmercifulness, you will reap unmercifulness. So be careful how you judge people. This goes beyond just forgiveness, of course. God wants to be merciful to people. He wants us to look at them the same way he looks at them, through his eyes. He wants us to love them the way we want to be loved. And part of that is loving your enemies, which we spoke about when we were going through the end of Matthew 5, how God literally feeds his enemies by allowing them to have his reign, which grows their food. Now, in our day and age, I preached about this at Georgia Tech. You guys were there? Georgia Tech on Thursday, I preached about this very thing, that in our day and age, we don't think about agriculture very much. I mean, who here grows all their food? Who here grows some of their food? Oh, okay, so not many, right? So we don't think about agriculture and planting things and taking care of them and tending to them and praying for rain to come, because rain doesn't come, we're not going to have any crops. We have hoses, right? We have wells in the ground. We have water coming from the road, from the city, or from the county. We don't think about those things, but back in those days, they needed water. Understand? They didn't have big water towers in the city. They didn't usually have these wells that had hoses coming out of them that can water their crops. They needed water from God. And the fact that he allowed them to have his rain, he sent the clouds and let it come out to grow their crops, to feed them, is the mercy of God. You know, that's the mercy of God. It's the love of God that does that. I mean, he wouldn't even have to actively punish them, like destroy their crops. All he had to do was just simply withhold the blessing of his reign. And then the land of the wicked would perish and they would die off pretty quickly. But God doesn't do that. He's so merciful toward his enemies that he gives them his reign and feeds them while they blaspheme his name, while they curse his name, while they sin against him day in and day out. He's merciful towards them. That's how we're to be merciful. The wicked also breathe God's air. I mean, We've studied the Old Testament. We've seen the land of Goshen, how God, the plagues, the 10 plagues hit Egypt, but not Goshen. God could very well simply withhold his heir from every wicked person and give his heir to every righteous person. That's a blessing from God. That's the mercy of God that he allows them to breathe his air while they continue to sin in hopes that they'll continue to live and eventually repent. And God does all of this from a place of perfect holiness, perfect wisdom, and perfect love. So if God's doing that from perfect holiness, wisdom, and love, it should be easier for us to do it. You know, since we have sinned thousands of times in our life. Tens of thousands, some of us. And so we have made thousands of mistakes, too. I'm not talking about sin, I'm talking about mistakes. You know, we're all humans, we all make mistakes, all of us. None of us has been or is perfect in that way at all. These facts should cause us to be merciful and to have a heart of mercy towards others, wanting them to come to a knowledge of the truth and have salvation. Turn to James 2. James chapter 2, starting in verse 8. James 2:8. If you really fulfill the royal law according to the scripture, you shall love your neighbor as yourself, you do well. But if you show partiality, you commit sin and are convicted by the law as transgressors. Whoever shall keep the whole law and yet stumble in one point, he is guilty of all. For he who said, do not commit adultery, also said, do not murder. Now, if you do not commit adultery, but you do murder, you have become a transgressor of the law. So speak and so do as those who be judged by the law of liberty. For judgment is without mercy to the one who has shown no mercy. Mercy triumphs over judgment. Just to clarify in verse 10 where it says you're guilty of all, it's not saying that if you've never committed murder, you're guilty of murder, okay? It's not saying that if you've never lied, which I think we all have lied, that you're guilty of lying. It's simply saying that if you have broken God's law at all, you're guilty as a lawbreaker and stand condemned under God's law. So if you play favorites or you're an adulterer, or you're a murderer, or you're a liar, you each stand in the same place, guilty under God's law as lawbreakers. They've all broken God's law and deserve his judgment, making them in the same situation, in need of repentance and forgiveness from God. So we'll all be judged by the same law. This should cause us to want to be merciful towards others. Not only because we have sinned in great ways in the past, but also because we could sin in some great way in the future. None of us here lack the ability to sin. None of us here lack the ability to be tempted. For none of us here lack the ability to sin in great ways in the future. Of course, we can do certain things to make sure it doesn't happen, but it's never a guarantee that we won't sin again in the future. And because we're going to want the mercy of God in such situations, it should cause us to be merciful now. And if you judge someone harshly now, right? Not out of the Spirit of God leading you, but as some kind of fleshly zeal. And then it happens to be that you do the same thing later on. What are you expecting to happen to you when you judge someone else harshly? So make sure you're giving mercy to others. I don't know about you, but I'd rather have judgment with mercy than judgment without mercy. If I could choose between those two things. Mercy triumphs over judgment. There's not some trophy you're going to get from God because you judge someone harshly. You understand? There's no trophy. Oh, you got first place for being the most harsh judger in the world. Right? But there is something that triumphs over that. Mercy triumphs over that. And so if you have the opportunity, if you have the choice, extend mercy. And mercy. Let's be merciful to each other and to others, whether we're talking about sin, actual sin, or just mistakes. And this will help you. It helps me as being a father. I look at my children and listen. They're not where I'm at, right? Not spiritually, not lack of making mistakes, right? So I try to be merciful. I look at them and say, look, they're not, I mean, They're doing a lot better than I was when I was their age, that's for sure. Because I was foolish. But I look at them, I don't try to judge them how I judge myself. I judge them according to their age, according to their ability. And I want to be merciful towards them. And you know what I found? There's times in the past I've judged them too harshly for forgetting something. Simply really, legitimately forgetting something. Not just being, saying they forgot, they really didn't forget. And then later on, you know what happens to me? I forget something. Right? And then what am I expecting from them? Mercy? Well, I better watch myself. Why? You know, I gotta make sure I'm not judging them too harshly for making a mistake if I want them to not judge me harshly when I make a mistake. And guess what? Their memories are probably just gonna get better. You know how my memory's going? Downhill. That's where my memory's going. Only by the grace of God is what it is now. Okay? Romans 1. And we'll start in verse 26. For this reason, God gave them up to vile passions, for even their women exchanged the natural use for what is against nature. Likewise, also the men, leaving the natural use of the woman, burned in their lust for one another, men with men, committing what is shameful, and receiving themselves the penalty of their error, which was due. Classic verse to talk about homosexuality. Verse 28. And even as they did not like to retain God in their knowledge, God gave them over to a debased mind to do those things which are not fitting, being filled with all unrighteousness, sexual immorality, wickedness, covetousness, maliciousness, full of envy, murder, strife, deceit, evil-mindedness. They are whisperers, backbiters, haters of God, violent, proud, boasters, inventors of evil things, disobedient to parents, undiscerning, untrustworthy, unloving, unforgiving, unmerciful, who, knowing the righteous judgment of God, that those who practice such things are deserving of death, not only do the same, but also approve of those who practice them. So we look at this passage. It's one that's commonly appealed to, I believe, when we deal with sinners in the open air, if we preach the gospel on the streets. It contains a list of sinners that none of us want to be on. I mean, who here wants to be a homosexual? Who wants to be sexually immoral? Murderers? Haters of God? Violent? Proud? Inventors of evil things? Who wants to be on that list? But in the midst of all these sins, you know what's found there? Unmerciful. Unmerciful is found right there in the midst of all that really crazy, abominable stuff. Unmerciful is found there along with it. Okay? Go back to James 1. You break a part law, you become guilty of it. You're a lawbreaker. So we don't want to be on this list at all. Not just the really, really bad stuff as people look at it, but the little things that people look at here, the unmerciful, right? We don't want to be on that list because that's on there too. And so we need to make sure that we're being merciful towards others. As we go back to Matthew now, that's what Jesus is trying to communicate to us here in verse 2. With the judgment you judge, you will be judged. With the measure you use, we measure it back to you. You'll reap what you sow in your judgment. So make sure your judgment has mercy. You're not so harsh, so quick to be harsh. And I found the people who are quick to be harsh, I mean, what the really root issue is what Kevin prayed about a little while ago. They've lost love. Their love is growing cold. Because their love is growing cold, their mercy extended to others is also growing cold. How about love is hot? We're going to be like God. Like I said before, he lets the wicked breathe his air and use his rain to feed themselves. He tells them to continue to live the sin. I hope they might repent. May we be the same way. Verses 3 and 4. And why do you look at the speck in your brother's eye, but do not consider the plank in your own eye? Or how can you say to your brother, let remove the speck from your eye, and look, a plank is in your own eye. Okay, so the Greek word translated as speck here in the New King James Version is karphos, and it means a small piece of straw, chaff, or wood to denote something quite insignificant. Now, we've all had something in our eye before, right? A little speck in our eye. It's not pleasant, right? Not pleasant at all. But the point of it here, to some degree, is to denote something that's quite insignificant. The Greek word translated as plank in the New King James Version is dakos, and it means a heavy piece of timber, such as a beam used in roof construction or to bar a door. Now, many of you have seen, at least seen, movies, or you may have seen it in person, where there's a bar put across a door to stop something from getting in that's on the outside. It's a big piece of wood. And look up there, right there. Look up right there where you can see. There's big, long pieces of wood there used for roofing. Okay? So we have it down now, the words down, the comparison. Small speck, we've all experienced that. One of those beams right there sticking out of someone's eye. Do you see the difference? The insignificant compared to the significant. Hopefully you can see why Jesus used these words. They are there to compare and contrast. They are there to represent the plausible and the absurd. So that's probably never happened. They are there to represent the big and the small, the significant and the insignificant in comparison at least. Okay? And Jesus gives an example of this later on in Matthew. Let's turn to Matthew 23. He gives us an example of this very thing. Matthew 23, starting in verse 23. Jesus says, "Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites! For you pay tithe of mint and anise and cumin, and neglected the weightier matters of the law, justice and mercy and faith. These you ought to have done without leaving the others undone. Blind guides, you strain out a gnat and swallow a camel." Notice, Jesus is not saying that they shouldn't obey the law of Moses, even down to the smallest details. He's saying they've neglected the bigger details, the things that are repeated over and over again, and they have more importance. In other words, they cross all their T's, they dot all their I's, but they have every word misspelled, and their sentences make no sense, and they had used no other form of punctuation. That's a great book, though. I crossed all my T's and dotted all my I's. I don't know where a sentence begins and where it ends. What is this word right here? It's like jumbo. Just jumbo together, right? That's what it's like to do this. They strain out a gnat and swallow a camel. I mean, can you imagine trying to swallow a camel? Is there a creature alive today that can swallow a camel? Maybe a big whale, right? Maybe a Amazon River python could swallow a camel. I have no idea. They've tried to swallow things like that before. But that's what he's saying here. May this not be said of us. Maybe we don't want to be one of those people who help others with very minute details about things, Bible doctrine, living out the Christian life. But we don't actually know and obey God in the obvious and walk according to the basics of the Christian life. Okay, back to Matthew 7. So Jesus is not saying here that we shouldn't be trying to help a brother, a sister, or a sinner get the speck out of their eye. I'm not saying that. Or that we shouldn't have a loving concern for someone with a speck in their eye. Listen, specks in your eye are bothersome, can hurt you, end up eventually doing severe damage and left there, and can impair your ability to see. Those are all true statements. Jesus knows all this, and the problem is that someone should first consider the plank or beam in their own eye. That's much more dangerous to you than a speck in someone else's eye. And literally, you have to be severely blind to not even notice a beam sticking out of your eye, especially if your other eye is still good. How could you not even see it? I mean, my glasses are like a few inches from my face. I can see the rims of my glasses with my eyes as I look at them. Who couldn't see a beam sticking out of their eye? And roofing beams, just so you know, usually about 12 to 20 feet long. That's really far to not notice that. So you have to be severely blind to not notice it. You have to also be of no help to any other person who has a plank in their eye, let alone a speck. I mean, even if you had a perfect vision in your other eye, how could you help someone out who has a speck in their eye without hurting them worse? You'd hurt them worse. You'd make their situation worse than it already is.
You're better off leaving the speck in their eye and not saying anything to them than try to speck out their eye when you have a plank in your eye. I mean, you could possibly saw off some of the beam, right? It's like sticking out of your eye 12 to 20 feet. You saw it off, so it's just like a foot out of your eye now, right? Just sticking a foot out. Now, maybe then you could help someone with a speck in their eye, get the speck out without hurting them worse. But then, to cut it off to a foot long, you'd have to actually acknowledge it's there, wouldn't you? You couldn't claim blindness anymore. Now you know it's there. And now you're actually saying, by cutting most of it off, that you're not willing to properly deal with it. That's what you're communicating by doing that. So in the spiritual truth, you're still not able to help someone out who has something in their eye and is walking in some kind of blindness, even if you want to cut down the plank in your eye down to a small piece of wood. But it makes no sense, naturally or spiritually, to help someone get a speck out of their eye while you still have a plank sticking out of yours. They should be helping you. The person with the speck should be helping you. The person who you're trying to help while you have a plank in your eye, really, you should be seeking help from them. Because they're in a much better place than you're in at that point in time. That's the hypocrisy of it all. Or better yet, they should get the speck out of their own eye before trying to help you get the plank out of your eye. Right? So just a survey real quick. Who here has ever had something in their eye, and why they have something in their eye, try to help someone else get something out of their eye? Okay. Thank you for being honest, brother. And who here has seen someone else try to get something out of someone else's eye where they have something in their eye? Okay. Now in the moment, well, maybe now you look back at it with 20/20 vision, right? Because hindsight is always 20/20, right, Paul? So as you look back at it now, do you see how foolish that was? And really, if we have two people with something in their eye, they shouldn't be trying to help themselves. They should seek out what? Someone who has clear vision. Someone who can see clearly. Who has nothing in their eye. Only that person can truly help them. Right? Only that person. Because if you talk about something in your eye, we're having someone put their eye open like this and look up and look right. We have them look all over the place to see where it is, right? And you have to have really good vision to see this tiny little speck in there somewhere. Maybe it's a bug flu in there or some kind of speck of wood. You have to have really good vision to see it. Right? That's what you're trying to find, like a needle in a haystack, so to speak. And then getting it out, try to keep the person's eyelids open. Right, Mo? While you're trying to get something out of their eye. They're constantly trying to close their eye.
Oh, yeah.
Right? So it's very difficult, even with good eyes. So far, we've seen that Jesus is not speaking against judgment at all. Overall, he's speaking against judging others first before judging yourself. Judge yourself first, and then you're fit to judge others. Realizing that we should be merciful to others the same way that God is merciful to others. He also speaks about the same way we're judging others, the same way we want to be judged, with mercy, which is simply the second greatest commandment, right? Loving your neighbor as yourself. Also, not that the speck should not be dealt with at all, but the plank should be looked at and dealt with first. And also the illogic, the foolishness, the absurdity of not properly dealing with the plank first. What did Jesus talk about so far in these first four verses? All he's talked about. Nothing against judging overall. Nothing saying that judging's a sin. Just those things we just mentioned. Now in verse 5. Hypocrite, first remove the plank from your own eye, and then you will see clearly to remove the speck from your brother's eye. Now, if you really want to help a person with a speck, here are the instructions of Jesus. You ever not read the instruction manual when you got something? Well, here's the instruction manual right here. Want to know how to remove a speck from someone's eye? Jesus gives instruction manual right here on how to remove the speck from someone's eye. First, realize you're a hypocrite for looking at someone's speck. Even though it may be a big speck, or it might cause them some serious issues if left alone, while you have a plank in your own eye. That may seem harsh, that Jesus is calling someone a hypocrite for doing that, but the truth can seem that way if you're deceiving yourself. Otherwise, the truth is freeing. See, the truth is freeing. If you see the truth properly, you'll see it as, I'm in chains, I'm being set free. If you see it improperly, you may see this guy's come out with this big saw to saw off these chains. What's he going to do, cut off my leg instead? No, he's coming to set you free. So the harsh truth may seem harsh if you're deceiving yourself. But if you see the truth as it is, and you don't blame the truth, but you blame yourself for being blind, you'll see how loving the truth is. After you see yourself as a hypocrite, second, remove the plank. This may seem pretty obvious. Most instructions are from God. It's simple enough. That doesn't mean it'll be easy, though. Removing a plank from your eye? Think that'll be easy? It may require a major surgery to remove the plank. You might need to pluck your eye out. It might cost you your eye altogether. You might need some time to heal up and recover after removing a plank from your eye. You might not be able to remove those nasty old huge specks from the eyes of others for a while as your eye heals. But at least you won't have a 20-foot beam coming out of your face anymore, right? That sounds pretty nice, doesn't it? To not have a 20-foot beam coming out of your face anymore. At least you'll truly be able to see properly again, eventually. It's like when your eyes are going bad. Stop my mother said yesterday. She's talking about how bad her eyes are getting for things that are up close. My eyes are still fine up close. They're just getting bad far away. But it's like when your eyes are going bad and you get glasses for the first time. Or it's like when you have to update your prescription you haven't updated in 5 years. And you put those new glasses on, there's new contacts in. It's like, wow, a whole new world opens up to you. I didn't realize that was over there and it said that. That's what it's like to have a plank removed from your eye. That's what it's like to not be a hypocrite any longer. It's like you have new sight. You don't have to squint, wait 5 minutes for your eyes to adjust, or look through a field of blur to try to figure out what something says, or try to read a book like this. Yeah, it's pretty nice. Yeah, I like that. Right, bro? You don't have to read like that. Once you get some glasses, you don't have to do that anymore. Right? When it's all said and done, when you get the log taken out and you begin to see clearly again, you'll have a proper perspective, which is definitely required in judging. A proper perspective, discernment, and sight in order to help others remove their specks and their beams. And it just takes a steady hand, a careful hand to remove stuff out of people's eyes. Third, this is when you can actually start helping others. You'll be able to see their issues truly as God sees them. You can help them remove the speck in a safe way. You can admonish them to keep their eyes clear. And also the danger of leaving the speck in until it grows into a plank. Because you've been there and done that. You've been a hypocrite. You've been blind. And this is the way ministry is done. If you've escaped your sin by the help of God, by the knowledge of God, now you're able to help others escape from their sin with God's help, if they want to escape, of course. Some are willing to stay blind and have acclimated their lives to live with the specks and their planks in their eyes. They learn to live spiritually blind, just like someone who is naturally blind learns to live with their lack of sight. However, could you imagine someone who doesn't have natural eyes, they can't see, they're blind, and they find out a way to get their sight? Cheap, quickly, painless, and they refuse it. But that's what people are like in a much, much worse way, who have the understanding of how to be spiritually have sight and reject it. I mean, how much more absurd is it to live in spiritual blindness when Jesus offers eye salve to give to those in order for them to have eyes to see? So contrary to what others may say about verse 1 or this passage as a whole, it's definitely not against judging, not even telling us not to judge. In fact, it's a passage on how to judge properly. The exact opposite. Judge yourself first. Don't judge others more harshly than you want to be judged. Judge things according to their importance. Judging is ultimately meant to be helpful. People don't always see it the way that's what it's meant for. If you really want to judge someone else properly, you need to get the sin out of your lives first. Not only is it wrong, but it makes no sense to judge small things in the lives of others when you have big things to deal with in your own life. In fact, verse 6, Jesus is telling us to judge again. Do not give what is holy to dogs, nor cast your pearls before swine, lest they trample them under their feet and turn and tear you in pieces. Now, how in the world are we supposed to know what a dog is, what something holy is, what a pig is, and what a pearl is, if we aren't supposed to be judging? Someone please explain that to me. So right after Jesus explains how to judge, he tells us to judge. So how do we decide what to give to dogs and pigs if we can't judge? Now, I don't have any pigs. I have 3 dogs and about 30 chickens now. Sold some chickens recently. You know what I feed the dogs? Dog food. Every once in a while, they get some scraps or some human food that we want to bless them with. You know what I feed chickens? Chicken food. Yeah, I feed them chicken food. Every once in a while, they'll get scraps too, and that we don't eat. I definitely wouldn't take some of the unleavened bread and give it to a dog or chicken. Right? I wouldn't take some expensive jewelry and throw it out with the corn that my chickens are eating. Have them gobble it up and they'd probably die from it. No rags from that chicken. Right? It's those things are too valuable to me. Too valuable, jewelry too valuable to give to a dog or a chicken. That'd be very, very bad judgment. It's judgment. Isn't it judgment? To give jewelry to a chicken or to a pig or to give unleavened bread to a dog, that's judgment, isn't it? It's just bad judgment. In the same way, we need to properly judge what truths to give people after we have removed the plank from our own eye and we see clearly. Only then will we see clearly what each person needs to hear from us. And everybody's different. It's a general message that can go out to lots of people. When you're talking one-on-one in small groups, you become more specific and detailed about what you give each person. You know what they need as you judge and discern with the help of the Holy Spirit. So contrary to what others may say, I don't think verse 6 has anything to do with calling sinners dogs or sinners pigs or deciding I can't preach the word of God to them because they're a sinner or they're a certain kind of sinner. How else can a sinner be saved but to hear the word of God preached to them? Now God may call us to refrain at some or stop at some point. That's definitely possible. In those situations, that would require proper judgment and discernment. But it's not a blanket judgment that whoever you decide is a dog or a pig, it doesn't tell us who they are, right? Just talking about dogs and pigs here, literal dogs and pigs. It doesn't call a certain person a dog or a pig. And if God, if Jesus is doing that here, surely he would give us some kind of specifications. But someone is a homosexual and a sodomite, a transgender, they're a dog. Don't give them anything. Some people think that. Where they say it with their mouth, and they say it by their actions, right? So I'm not calling sinners dogs and pigs here, or swine. And if Jesus is saying that, he would give us some kind of details. Well, if they're this, 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 and this, they're a dog. If this, 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 they're a swine. And therefore, you can't give them God's word because it's holy. It's like a pearl. You can't give it to them. But it's talking about literal, in my opinion, literal dogs and literal pigs here. So Jesus, oftentimes, people try to combine what Jesus said in Matthew 10 to his disciples about in certain situations where people in a certain city or a certain house are not receiving them to dust off their feet and walk away from that city. And they'll combine it with verse 6. But I don't think what Jesus said in Matthew 10 is a blanket statement for all of us. You know, there are times I know that it seemed like the crowd I'm preaching to that day is just completely opposed to me. Just railing on me, saying the filthiest things to me, threatening violence towards me, trying to intimidate me. And I walk away, and I'm still encouraged, still the joy of the Lord. They didn't steal my joy, right? I walk away, And people come to me and say, man, I'm so thankful you did that. I'm so appreciative. And then there's people who come to me who've been listening in the background who I'm not really seeing. They're not in the forefront. I'm not really seeing with my eyes. And they come up and I say, well, look, see, God's doing a work here. Right? There's also been times, I preached at this college called Middle Tennessee State University in Murfreesboro, Tennessee. This is back in like 2009, I think, 2008. Preached there with a couple other guys, and violence was done to one of them. He was thrown down off a 4-foot high ledge. His ribs got hit on a metal trash can really hard. Had to take him to the hospital. I think he had some cracked ribs. And that student got suspended from the school. We went there like 3 more times a semester. Just everybody was opposed to it. Not one person, an encouraging word. The local news was there trying to twist things and make it seem like we're evil. And I prayed about it some more. I said, well, I'm not going back there. I didn't go there for 4 years. Everybody who was there, that first semester I preached, they were all gone by then. I went back there 4 years later, it was completely different. See, there's ways God can lead us like that, but to take this and make it a blanket statement, well, all those people who are dogs and pigs, I'm there preaching to them again. Well, you don't know what God will do in their life later on to humble them and cause you to speak to them again. Okay? So we need to make sure that we think about these things from the whole counsel of God. You know, there's even times in the Old Testament where God sent his prophet to a rebellious house. And he said to them, they will not listen to you, but go to them anyway. You see? So it's not a blanket statement about everybody. So when it comes to the message we proclaim, we must judge and be discerning about what to give each crowd, each group, and each individual. You must walk according to biblical principle. God resists the proud. So when I give the proud, I give them a message of law, sin, repentance, judgment, and hell. That's what the proud get. But if someone is humble, well, God gives grace to the humble. So you know how to give the humble? I give a message of God's grace, God's love, God's mercy, and the cross. Now, with both sides, I mix in a little bit of other stuff, too. You understand? They get the whole message. But the focus is changed because of the state of the heart of the person. That's how we judge and discern what to give each person. And this is what I believe Jesus is calling us to do in verse 6. So we look at this whole, just these 6 verses right here. I could have went to John 7:24, you know, 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verses 15. I could have went to James. I could have went to all different, Romans. I could have went to all these passages to do a really thorough treatment of the word judgment and judging. It's not how God led me today. But I want you to see that just by staying in this passage, you can show people they're wrong about what it says. You know, we don't have to always go to another verse to prove their understanding of a certain verse wrong. Not like we're making the Bible fight itself, right? Sword against sword. We can go straight to the verse they're talking about and show them that they're wrong about it. And we go even further, and later on he says in verse 15, beware of false prophets. Well, how do I know what a false prophet is if I can't judge? How do I beware of them? I can't even call someone a false prophet, let alone judge them as one, so how can I beware of them? So Jesus is constantly calling us to judge people and judge situations, but we must judge properly. We must not judge as hypocrites. We must judge with mercy, not harshly at all times. So we see these 6 verses, we see, contrary to what people say, it's not against judging. It's actually telling us how to judge and how to judge properly. And if we do it, what the verses say, we'll be successful in God's eyes and he will bless the work of our hands. All right, well, we'll stop there for today. If anyone has questions or objections or things you want to add, now's the time to do it.
Yeah, and when you were describing having a beam in the eye and helping someone with a speck in theirs, you know, it really made me think about, you know, how Jesus said that the blind leading the blind, they both end up in a ditch. Mm-hmm. Like, hypothetically, I'm living in some sort of sin, right? And I'm trying to tell somebody else who's in some form of similar sin or something, they have stopped doing that, right? I'm not going to lead them in the right direction. Why? Because I myself don't even know how to stop doing it. Mm-hmm. How can I teach somebody else or help somebody else and how to stop doing it?
Yeah.
You know, we're both going to end up going away from that spirit if that person was even here in the first place.
Yeah, I mean, you can give them words that are accurate and truthful, but there's no power behind it.
Exactly.
Because you have sin in your life and you're not living by the power of the Holy Spirit yourself.
Amen.
Which is really what is needed to live holy.
Exactly.
Not just mere words from a book. Yeah. Actually the spirit behind the book too. Amen.
Saying though, the first thing to get around that a little bit is the first thing you got to do is admit that you commit the same sin. I mean, if you can admit to somebody that you have the same problem they have, then you can work together to find the answer.
Yeah. Of course, you need to get the plank out of your eye first,
right,
before you can see clearly. You can't leave the plank in there and help anyone. And the plank in this situation representing sin. So if you still have the plank in your eye, you got to take it out. And that can only be done by the grace and mercy of God, by the power of God. You can take it out. And only then can you help someone else if you've received help yourself. And the great physician brings healing to your eyes. He gives you the eye salve that he offers. Only then can you offer to others. You know?
And yeah, bro, it's good. I know there's been some times in the past where it's like, as far as like giving judgment, there's been some times where I haven't like taken into account that the realization that like, you know, because like it's easy, you know, when you're obviously like we're living holy, but obviously we still have the ability to sin. It's like taking that into account that keeps you humble, you know, not like you're some spiritual giant.
Right.
You
know, exactly.
Keeps you very humble and still keep that into account at all times. Definitely.
Amen, brother.
Your heart will be different.
Amen. For sure.
And yeah, thanks for listening to the Lord and sharing the way you did today and not going the other way. It was just perfect timing. You know, just some things that the Lord was even reminding me of this morning. And when we're out there on the street, you know, it was just, it's something that the Lord spoke to me when we were in Lexington. I think I shared a little bit about that, but when I was, there was a man out there, he's not right with God, his attitude's not right, his reaction is not right to my my offer. And instead of, the Lord's concerned with how we do things.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
That's right.
What spirit you are of. You know, maybe someone deserves like fire from heaven to be sent down on. Shall we call fire from heaven to come down on?
No.
You don't know what spirit you're of.
Right.
You know what I mean? Like, that's a little bit harsh, right? Sons of thunder, like that's I don't think we want to have that nickname.
That's right. I think some would love to have it though, bro.
Some do. Some do love to have that.
But it was a derogatory term. It wasn't like a blessing or like a commendation.
Exactly.
Called Sons of Thunder.
No, you don't know what spirit you're of. In other words, that's not my spirit.
That's right.
That's not my spirit. They were being harsh, right? But there is some reaction that's being given to them, and then there's a reaction back, right? Let's flame them. And so that's something that the Lord, you know, even just that, wasn't a big thing, but it was big to the Lord. You know, we don't want to treat something, get casual with that and treat it like it's just a small thing. Mm-hmm. You know, I was harsh that time, just a small thing. It's not a small thing because you're misrepresenting the Lord.
That's right.
And when Moses misrepresented the Lord, he didn't get to go on the promised land. What do you mean? I've been serving you 40 years out here? You know, leading the people out here 40 years? I don't get to go in the promised land?
Mm-hmm.
That's a representative. That wasn't my spirit.
Right.
You know? Obviously. And it was a picture there too, obviously, of Christ being stricken once. But at that, so sharing about that, about the being merciful, and then that Romans 1 passage, whoa, brother.
Wow.
Like we're gonna find ourselves in Romans 1? Whoa. You know, I mean,
yeah.
I don't want to be there.
That opened my eyes too.
I don't want to be there. That's the spirit in my heart. Like, and especially when we're out there and you're you're getting things hurled at you, and you know, we all experience it, getting things hurled at you. Just, you got to stay tenderhearted. I mean, we have to stay on the cross, you know, come down from the cross and start blowing and getting in fights with people, you know what I mean? Well, you got to come down the cross to start fighting with people like that. I mean, that's what you have to do.
Right.
Jesus could have came down from the cross. You know, they're saying, come down from the cross, you know, come off that cross. He could have come down from the cross and just wipe them all out.
Right.
But that's not what he preached from the cross. I mean, he preached some things from the cross. And, you know, the Lord tells us to pick up our cross. And it's a demonstration of the Lord that the Lord wants us to show. And so just that being merciful as he is merciful, and mercy triumphing over judgment. You know, as I said, the Lord does want us to judge righteously, but we got to be real careful with that. You know what I mean? And I think that's what the Lord is speaking to us today. You need to be careful, you know? And the best, like you shared, is like remembering the mercy that's been shown to us. You know, that's so good. The Lord's been merciful to us. And am I going to be harsher than God on somebody? Mm-hmm. I'm going to be harsher on somebody than God is? I mean, there's a reason why the Lord says give place to wrath. You know, there's a day of wrath coming.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there's a day of wrath. And like in Jude, I'm looking at verses as you're sharing. In Jude 1:15, you know, there's a lot of harsh things that are spoken against the Lord. Well, he's coming on that day and to execute judgment. There is judgment coming on all the harsh things that are spoken. So when the harsh things are spoken to us, are we supposed to be harsh back? Is that really what God wants us to do? Well, Jesus went in the temple and overturned the tables, and he dealt with people harshly, right? So that's my approval. Now that's how I'm supposed to deal with people.
Right.
I'm supposed to be like Jesus going in the temple, cleansing the temple.
Right.
When I go downtown some place, I'm supposed to turn over tables and money changers and whipping people and...
I don't remember.
That makes God sick.
Mm-hmm.
And I appreciate that, brother. It's so needed. So we don't become sick like that.
Right.
I mean, because I think that's sick behavior.
Yeah.
And so if I think we all should keep each other accountable. If any of us starts to see any of us veer that way,
mm-hmm.
we should be open to a loving reproof.
Mm-hmm.
Say, hey, brother.
Sure.
Merciful. You know, whatever.
Mm-hmm.
Suffer a little longer.
Right.
Be a little more long-suffering.
Yeah.
And if I give you all permission, if you ever see something like that happen in me, just say,
yeah.
Love is patient, love is kind.
Yeah.
Love suffers long, love is kind.
Mm-hmm.
You know, don't get to start behaving rudely. You know.
Yeah.
Appreciate that message, brother.
Amen, bro. It's very easy to look at those times Jesus turned the mind changers tables over in the temple courts and different things in the scripture like that and just give a blanket approval to whatever you do. That seems to be in the same category. It's very easy to do that. It's much harder to examine yourself and see if you're actually walking in the Spirit or not in those situations, for sure.
I think a lot of people too justify what calling it a righteous anger.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I guess that when they say that, then anything goes at that mm-hmm. point, you know, saying that. Because I remember one brother that would constantly say that everything was a righteous anger and kind of justify his preaching methodology with that blanket statement alone, you know. And I think that can also be a trap and a snare for someone who has anger uncontrollably, really is what it is.
No.
But
outbursts of wrath.
Yeah, that's right.
On the works of the flesh.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
And self-control is definitely a fruit of the Spirit. Self-control is
long-suffering. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it makes me think about Ephesians. It says to put on the full armor of God. And you know, you look, and I'm not supporting this, but you look at like American soldiers when they're overseas, they have rules of engagement. They can't just go and start shooting at certain people because of their appearance. They have to righteously judge and determine whether it's a threat. And the only way to do that is to let that person lash out first. And or out there in the streets, you know, it's almost like we have like a spiritual rule of engagement. Mm-hmm. It's like how we conduct ourselves, like, you know, and obviously we don't rend. The metaphor falls apart because we don't shoot back at people, but
spiritually,
yeah, exactly. Amen. It's like when we're out there, you know, we don't just go out there and straight up, you're a sinner. Like, it shows up when they start opening their mouth and the filth comes out, and then we're like, listen, man, you're in sin. You need to repent.
Yeah,
it's like rules of engagement, you know.
That's good because I was having the same thought this morning as I was thinking about these things and thinking about how if somebody comes out and so we have spiritual weapons, let's just say somebody comes out and they poke you, and you pull out the guns and blaze them. That's not appropriate.
Not at all.
Not an appropriate reaction. Mm-hmm. Why don't you just let yourself get hit? You know? I mean, so spiritually speaking, I see that. You know what I mean? And a gentle answer, maybe.
Yeah.
Maybe. I mean, maybe it's better to err on the side of... You can actually speak a rebuke in a right heart.
Of course.
You know, gently.
Mm-hmm.
The gentle answer doesn't mean, Jesus loves you. Doesn't mean that.
Yeah.
Somebody says, Jesus loves you. It could be, Jesus loves you. Maybe not in that, you know, squeaky thing. but it could actually be a rebuke, but said, speak the truth in love.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Let your speech be full of grace, seasoned with salt, that you may know how to answer that stuff coming at you.
Yeah.
And so it can be done the right way.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Could it be done the right way? Jesus was full of grace and truth, not just truth.
Yeah.
So we just blind people with truth.
Yeah.
Sword spear. Truth, man. Sword spear. He's hacking people up. You know what I mean? But and Sonia, the sister, new sister in Modesto, she actually knows that. Amen. So grace and truth.
Yeah.
That's good. This is really good, brother. I'm really thankful for this word.
Tommy was perfect.
Yeah.
God is so perfect.